asking our entrepreneurs briefly about what their businesses do, give as many specifics as possible in the first minute or so. And then in terms of keeping it practical, I think it's instructive to hear the creation stories behind these two companies. How do they think about starting a business targeting a country elsewhere and knowing what customer needs are in that market and selling into that market when you're based in India? That sounds tough, but I think it's instructive to hear your story. So please go ahead.
So my name is Paras, and
Hello.
My name is Paras, and I'm a CEO and founder of a company called Wingify. We make a product called Visual Website Optimizer. It is an A/B testing product that we started about 2.5 years back. Now we have about 1,900 customers across 50 plus countries. And we have bootstrapped along the way and consciously chose not to raise funding. So that is in brief what Wingify and Visual Website Optimizer is.
Hi, everyone. My name is Girish Mathrubhutam. I am the CEO and founder of Freshdesk. Freshdesk is an online customer support software. Prior to starting Freshdesk, for the past close to 10 years, I was with Zoho. In 2001 as a pre-sales engineer. In my last role, I was VP of product management at Zoho.
Let me just pull it out and hold it in front of
you. Yeah. Can you hear me? Yeah. So just to answer the how we started Freshdesk part of the story, I think you can always go online and read it. I've blogged about it. It's a very popular blog on the Freshdesk story. But to give you a quick snapshot, because it's relevant to the conversation that we're having here. So I was not your typical young, I don't know how old Paras is. How old are you, Paras?
We won't go there.
25.
Yeah, so I'm not your typical 25-year-old entrepreneur with no commitments. I was 36 years old with two kids and a home mortgage, which was pretty new. Like, I convinced my co-founder also to buy a house in March, and then we decided to start this company. We launched in October, but we decided somewhere around June. So it was a pretty tough decision. But how it happened was, so I was happy in my job. Zoho is a great company to work in, and I was in a pretty senior position. But what happened in May of 2010 was, I saw an article on Hacker News about how Zendesk, one of the cloud-based SaaS providers, had raised their prices by up to 300% on their existing customers. So now this was a trigger for me, because I was in the managed engine division of Zoho, but I was also able to see that SaaS was growing rapidly, and I had domain expertise in the customer support or help desk market. So I could actually also see that compared to a CRM or a project management, there was relatively fewer competition or fewer players in the help desk market, because help desk is usually boring. So that was like a eureka moment, when the relative competition in the space is low, and SaaS as a category is growing fast. So I thought maybe somebody like me with the relevant domain experience could come in and build a product and take on the leader from India. So that's great. How we started Freshdesk in October 2010. And just to give you some stats on, we have, as we speak, more than 2,000 customers in 70 countries around the world, and our product is 15 months old.
Thank you. Paras?
So I was very entrepreneurial throughout my college and school days, and I started programming when I was 12 or 13. So I had an early start in that sense. During college, I did a lot of projects that back then I called startups, and they were all idea based, in terms of I got a cool idea and then I would implement it probably in some music industry, in advertising industry. But all those so-called startups were very idea based, in terms of I thought they were cool and I thought it would make a very good startup, but they didn't really work out. One, I wasn't mature enough, and second, I now realize that with idea based startups, you had to create a market. So after doing these couple of startup projects, and I graduated in 2008, I worked with a company for about 2 years. But since I had to do something of my own always, I made a so I started exploring my interest. So my interest back then got matured into three main things. One was marketing, the other one was analytics, data mining, machine learning, because I had been programming in artificial intelligence and all the algorithms since school days. And the third was technology. So I thought, what would be a good field to explore my passions? And I made a list of 10 and 15 different ideas. So my startup wasn't really an idea based, or it wasn't really that I got an idea in the shower and I did it. I actually made a conscious list of the passions I had and which fields would let me explore those passions. So on top of the list was a field called marketing optimization, because it was about marketing, it was about optimization, which had to use a lot of data and it involved a lot of technology. So I thought this would be a really good field to enter into. So I started exploring it, I started exploring the solutions in the market, and I started talking to people who were using the different solutions. And a great advantage that I had was perhaps my naivety in this particular field. Because as we were talking earlier, in an already established field, people get very comfortable with the solutions that are there, and they assume that is all there it is in the market. But coming from the outside, I realized that there was so much difference that we can make by adding different things. So I realized the existing solution, which was Google Website Optimizer, that required a lot of input from technical people, but it was mainly meant for marketers. So it required a disruption. So we created Visual Website Optimizer, which would allow marketers to do without any IT help.
Great.
So that is the story.
Let me just riff off that a little bit. I mean, when we talked a little bit in previous panels about, you know, is there innovation in the Indian market here? Are we just doomed to be copycats in some sense? Can you talk a little bit about, you know, both of you are going after existing markets, customer service, help desk in one sense, website optimization in another sense. What is it in a more generalized way that you did to figure out why you would be something, your solutions would be something that would be new and innovative in that market? Those markets have existed on the client server side, now on the SaaS side. What's new? How did you think about doing something different in this market?
Okay, so I'll go first on that. So the first point I would like to add is, it's always, as an entrepreneur, it's better to target a large existing market than with competition than come up with some totally random idea. So when I say that, it's not about copycat marketing, it's about building something that people are already using. Andrew Cheng has a great blog post today about going after established markets, because it means that people have a budget for that, so they're searching for solutions. So the market being established is a great advantage. Second, how do you be innovative? So first thing, when we started, SaaS itself was a differentiator, because majority of the available customer support systems were on-premise. So we were probably a year or two late, but still, the opportunity in SaaS is still huge in front of us. So SaaS was a big innovator. And then we also found out that social was going to be a differentiator, because customers have started talking on, Twitter and Facebook, and brands are being brought to their knees. Customer support was changing from a one-to-one conversation between the customer and the company to a one-to-the-world conversation. Now, if I have a problem with the brand, I go online and I complain. Yesterday, I was actually showing this to a customer, and the company now has to respond. Now, this is a game changer in terms of identifying an opportunity to innovate in an existing market like customer support, where the majority of the world is still thinking that, oh, I just need a ticketing system, so I'll sit and wait for emails and phone calls from the customer. Now, as we progressed, we also found other opportunities. For example, 2 weeks ago, we launched gamification of the help desk. So basically, what we're trying to do is turn customer support, which is commonly known as a frustrating, boring, monotonous process, into a fun-filled environment where you bring make agents happy, you get customers happy. The point I'm trying to make is going after established markets is actually a good strategy if you know how to differentiate and how to build a better mousetrap, as we call it. Right? So,
yeah, I would agree with Girish. In fact, I would counter your point with saying what's wrong with being a copycat. When it's generally assumed that being copycat is bad, but if you're a single person, entrepreneur, not having any resources, not having a lot of resources in front of you, your first aim is to make money, right? That is the objective.
I think you had a good point before when we were talking before the panel, you know, going after the dissatisfied race. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, I was coming to that. Yeah. So in fact, any large market that is out there, there are always a segment of users or segment of customers who are dissatisfied with the existing solutions. So by copycat, you don't really mean that copycatting the solution, but copycatting the market. The market is out there, but what you have to do is to identify a very specific set of customers that can give you that first entry point. And that the first entry point is all you need to get into the market. And after that, you can always pivot and you can always expand your feature set to compete with the market leader directly. And that is how we did. When we entered, we really focused on making tool as easy to use as it can be. But now, once we have started getting customers, our objectives have changed. And now we are expanding our feature set so as to compete with the market leaders and not really being a copycat for that.
It feels to me a little bit like innovator's dilemma, where you're sort of going after that underserved market a little bit, or the unserved market, and you then expand from there.
Yeah.
It might be an existing market, which is not a bad thing. There's already money flowing into that market.
Yeah, you need an entry point into a market, and that could be a single differentiating factor while rest of the things are same.
So I think one point to add there is, as an entrepreneur sitting in India, and most of your customers are abroad, so how do you go about identifying the differentiators, right? I think today almost anything can be done sitting in front of a PC, like like what we did in terms of identifying how to differentiate ourselves initially was, so we read every forum post, every feature request that was on the competitors' forums, we looked at all the major players, found out what most people wanted, and surprisingly there were lots of insights on what people wanted was not being delivered for like 2-3 years. So now we could identify a pattern in terms of, okay, there is a segment of customers who I can target first. In our case, it was multi-product support. So companies which are supporting more than one product or one brand, like they were all being, like they had no way to do it from one help desk. So we identified that quickly. So latched on to that idea. So reprioritized everything else, put out the product. So what I'm saying is, you can listen in on social networks to what people are saying about competition, go and look at all their forums. So identify what are the current weaknesses in the current solution, and then come up with your innovative approach on how to tackle those.
Got it. I'll ask one more question, and then we go to questions from the audience. So if you want to line up there, please feel free to do so. I guess the final question here is, as you go about prosecuting your vision and idea and business plan, what are the main issues you've faced, and have you found any hacks to sort of solve these issues? Issues might be around hiring. Previous panel talked about lack of or lower availability of product management or UX, or selling into a market, acquiring customers abroad when you're sitting here. Any hacks that you've sort of worked really well for you as you've done this?
So I'll answer this from the context of the global market, in terms of if you're selling to 50 plus countries, what challenges? So we identified that we have two main challenges in front of us. One is the branding and offline part. So our US based competitors, since they are based out of US and most of our market is in the US, they're very good at being present at most of the events that are happening in the industry, be it around e-commerce, be it about PubCon and other events. So if we have to do that, we have to at least establish an office in the US, or at least have a person doing that. And it's a big task altogether. So having developing a brand through offline means, I think it will be difficult staying here in India. And the second part,
just to understand, what is the hack there? You actually had to put somebody in Silicon
Valley. So the hack there is to let your customers and partners do the talking. So instead of you do the talking, what we do, we have about 10 or 15 partners in the US who go and talk on events on our behalf and mention Visual Website Optimizer. So you have to really enable your customers who are in love with your product to be able to talk about your product. So you are not there physically, but at least your representatives are there.
Yep.
So you have to make your product so good. And you can simply enable them by providing slides, data, and being as transparent as you would be with your own employees.
Okay,
Paish. Yeah, so I'll share an interesting hack that I've developed over the years in hiring. So one of the tough things that we've always found is hiring good, say, content writers or UI designers in India. So what I've found over the years is in the Valley, you could probably go and hire somebody who's built product UI for LinkedIn for 5 years, for example. Such kind of talent is starting to emerge in India, but not easily available. So what we have found, what I have practiced over the years is look for base talent, what you call as like the ability to write. So for example, I'll share a story of how we got our first marketing content writer. We advertised on LinkedIn, got 85 people apply to it, right from freshers to people with 10 years of marketing content writing. So what I did was asked everybody to share something on what they wrote, either a link to their blog or samples of what they had written. Now I could see that many of the experienced people were writing marketing BS. So whereas I found one guy, a fresh MBA, who was working in a retail store, like a heritage retail, as a management trainee, but his blog, he was able to tell authentic stories and he was able to get comments from random visitors. So for me, that's the kind of guy whose passion is writing. So now we hired that guy and now he's a top-notch contributor in our blogs. So similarly, if you look at say product design guys, so you are looking at hiring UI UX guys from say the Yahoos and the VMwares of the world, but they're not going to easily jump over and join you as a startup, right? So how do you hack that? So what we have found out is, okay, you split the UI UX into say aesthetics and usability, right? So aesthetics part we have hired from say regional magazine designers. So guys who do awesome work in Photoshop can actually, they may not know a thing about say CSS or Ajax or whatever, right? But they do. It's God-given talent for the color sense and the design sense. So we take those guys and make them design. Then we hire people who can do CSS, which is actually a skill, so it's easily available in the market. So so we try to hack things like this, which comes from years of working with lots of teams to see, but I still find a lot of entrepreneurs trying, because of resources also, trying to find one guy who will do everything in UI or one guy who will do everything in marketing. So thus, kind of models are like hard, but God doesn't make them in large quantities. So,
got it. Thank you. Any questions? If you could just identify who you are and address it to somebody specifically.
Yeah, hi. My name is Haven. Both of you, I think, mentioned close to 2,000 customers, right? I also want to know what's your team size and all. What stage are you in? How many people?
So we are in fact 14 people.
We are 52 people and growing. So again, we are VC funded, so we have money to burn and we are growing fast. So that explains why we, and we have big plans for more to come. So
probably one last question as well is, how do you price, as in the pricing, right, for your product? You just went with A/B sort of model even there and put multiple pricing, see which one is working and then stuck to it, or is there some, what's the science to that really? How do you, for a SaaS based product?
Okay, so
maybe I can modify that a little bit. Relative to competition that you had in an existing market, how do you think about pricing?
So pricing is always, I don't think anybody has cracked the science of pricing yet. It's black magic, right? But Having said that, there are some guidelines to go about it. So the first thing is your target market. So if you are selling into, if you want to sell into larger enterprises with a direct sales force, you are obviously pricing it, you have to price it higher, probably around the say 30K, 50K per year kind of pricing. If you are going to target the Fortune 1000 or Fortune 2000, and those are the only guys who are going to buy your product. If you are going after the SMB, and if it's going to be a self-serve model where people are going to come and try your product and buy it, then your target audience is actually the, you're building it for the engineers, not the CEOs, right? So the engineers are going to evaluate your product. Then it obviously has to be much, much lower, probably in the, say, $50, $100 or $200, $300 per month range. Because beyond 5K or 10K, it's going to go through multiple levels of, as your price increases, the number of approvals increase. Now, having said that, within the context of, say, $50, $100, now how do you decide whether it's going to be $9 or $100? So, right, there competition plays a part, and it's also a discovery mechanism. Like I would say, great lessons can be learned from Microsoft. So, for example, Microsoft XP, the home version versus the professional version, right? There's just, I think, only one or two features that are different. And especially, in to my knowledge, the ability to authenticate against an Active Directory is the only feature that's different between a pro and a home. But any business would need it, and without the ability to authenticate against an Active Directory, they can't actually have it. So they price the pro version. So basically what I'm trying to say is, find out what's important for your larger customers. Like, for example, it could be custom SSL certificates, or so there may be smaller things which people are valuing more. So you can have a higher priced version for that. And your startups and your SMBs and nonprofits are the most price sensitive. So have a lower priced version for them. So basically our philosophy is never lose on price. So make it, leave some money on the table, because it's free marketing to get more customers on board.
Thank you.
Hi.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay. Hi, I'm Karthik. I'm Chief Nobody at Someplace. I have a question for Girish. Girish, I got the sense that when you were saying, when you were talking about your company and how you found Freshdesk and how you thought there was a space, I felt that there was a confusion between innovating and differentiating. Is that a typical challenge that startups feel, that if I need to be differentiated, if I need to be a differentiated brand, I need to innovate, or I can differentiate myself on pricing or model or etc.?
Okay. See, differentiation is more for positioning. The media, the VCs, right? And even customers, when they want to remember your brand among 100 brands that they meet at a trade show, so that's differentiation. So innovation is about making lives easier. So today, if I want to support customers through email and phone, I have a different team. And then to support customers on Twitter and Facebook, they're using some other tool. Now, building a combined tool to basically have everything in one place could be innovation. Using that innovation as a differentiation strategy is more of positioning your marketing message. Does it answer your question?
Yeah, no, I'm trying to simplify that.
I guess just to add to that, I think maybe innovation comes in different ways. It could be a technology innovation, it could be business model, it could be customer acquisition, it could be the way you market yourself in PR. There's lots of different ways of differentiating. But is there any one that you would pick as innovation versus differentiation? You can innovate in all areas.
Okay, so you can obviously innovate in each area. So for example, one of the things we did in my previous company was get rid of the form, right? So everybody was selling using white papers. You had to fill a form to download a white paper, or they send you a salesperson. So in 2003, what we did was we took away the form, gave the product for free, and then let the customer come and buy if they're satisfied. So that's innovation in the sign-up process, right? Or in the onboarding process. So okay. I think innovation is possible in every aspect of...
We'll take one last question and then we'll stop.
Hi.
Hi, Mahesh.
I wanted to ask you, I mean, it's interesting that both of you talked about not really entering green field, but really getting into very established markets. I also understand both of you are in B2B businesses. Is this something that you think would work primarily in B2B and not so much in consumer-driven businesses? Okay. So questions for both of you guys.
Okay, so I don't have a lot of experience in B2C, but I can tell you that in B2C, greenfield works, but you need a lot of, again, B2C is very generic. Virality is something which you have to build into your product today if you have to have any chance of rapid adoptions in terms of B2C. My experience in B2C is pretty minimal or non-existent, so. Yeah.
And I won't know anything about B2C as well.
Maybe Dave can take that.
It's a completely different ball game. So it's very hard to generalize across these two different domains.
All right, great. Thank you very much. And we'll go on to the next session.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.